You're listening to Cinema Red Pill. I'm Sharon.
I'm Timothy.
And I'm Joel.
Yeah, this is our 93rd episode of Cinema Red Pill. I hope I'm correct on that. Yeah, and on this episode, we'll be talking about The Mercy of the Jungle, a film by Joel Karekezi.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Right?
I'm going to talk a bit about this film and why we're talking about it. First of all, it won the first top prize at FESPACO in 2019, which is the last FESPACO that happened. FESPACO is like the Cannes of African cinema, really. Yes. But it's really the biggest thing, so that's the top prize. And it's cool for it to be like an East African film, because most times, the last winner was Félicité, which is
the
French.
Congolese.
Yes.
And in French.
That's amazing.
Amazing. You had said last time how most films are in French as well.
Yeah, man, Francophone films get all the love in Africa.
Moving on up, maybe Uganda will one day get a FESPACO film and somehow film in a different language. But yeah, it won top prize. It premiered at Toronto TIFF, Toronto International Film Festival. And yeah, it also showed in a bunch of festivals. The list is long. There's the Luxo African Festival. There's that that one that has the qualifier. The one that gives you the Oscar qualifier. Pearl of Africa or something?
PAF. Pan-African Film Festival.
That one, as well as the Durban one. Yeah, so it's pretty big. And more about it. It's a production between Belgium, France, Germany, and Rwanda. I kind of wish Uganda had some credit.
No, we should have credit because it was short.
We do. Yeah, Ugandans were up in there. Ali Musoke was doing the BTS. We had, we shout out Edna, Patience, Davidson, Michael Wawuyo Sr., Michael Wawuyo Jr. Ugandans are all up in that thing. Emma Gashumba, yeah, Abi Muchibi. Yeah, Ugandans featured, it was shot on Ugandan soil. We're also going to take our credits.
Yeah, we have to.
We say we facilitated.
But I wanted to even ask about that. Where exactly was it shot? I didn't get where. It was shot in Uganda. Where exactly?
Yes. Basing on the gorillas, I would say like Bwindise.
Yeah. It definitely was windy. Because, yeah.
Yes.
So my issue is where I'm saying we should get credit. Like on Wikipedia, the source of information, the country is listed. We're not there. Like we aren't really credited for doing shit. Like the blueprint on, like the footprint online, we are not really there. But in the credits, we are really there.
Yeah. No, but I think I saw something on where they put filming took place in Uganda. That's the only credit they give us.
Yeah.
But production, all those names, all those actors.
You know? It's okay. We're rewriting that injustice. Cinema Red Pill is here.
Right? We've
come
here
for our credit.
We are telling you, this is our movie also. We are talking about our movie, right? Like, we are taking ownership. This is what they lecture us about. Ownership.
Reclaiming.
Reclaiming what's ours. About Joel Karekezi, he was in the Maisha Film Lab and he had a short film that was produced there called The Pardon.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yes.
The Pardon is on YouTube. I'll link it as well in the our show notes, the notes of about this episode, because The Pardon is available on YouTube. And also this film we're talking about, The Mercy of the Jungle, is on Vimeo. You can get it on Vimeo. We watched it from Vimeo. We bought it.
Yes.
You can buy it for 39K and or you can get it for 48 hours streaming for 17K. So affordable shit. Do what we did. Split seas among people, you know.
And watch a good Africa.
We buy all our movies, by the way.
Say no to piracy.
No to piracy, right?
Yes.
I have to link this Bambi, guys. Please watch it if you can. It's available. But his film, The Pardon, was made into a feature film in 2015, which is in Babazi, The Pardon. It's also a film about the genocide, which I haven't yet talked about this film, but the previous film he made, The Pardon, is also about a genocide. This film that we're going to talk about is also about the genocide, but a world after the genocide, set in 1998.
Yeah.
And the Rwanda genocide took place in 1994. So this is just 4 years after. It's still pretty fresh. The film is set at the border of Rwanda and DC in an area called Chivu. And that area is really set up that is full of buried wealth. And these two regions want the wealth. So there's some strife for that, which because they both want it. There's soldiers on both sides, as well as a rebel group, which is included. And this is sort of a guerrilla war between the people. And one of the things that the film also makes note of is that this conflict is a detriment to the population of the people living in the area. We follow two main characters. One is called Faustin and the other is called Xavier. The lead character really is Xavier, I'd say. Yeah. But they're co-leads. The movie is about them. And it's their own some sort of journey. It's really seeing them go through this journey, because Faustin and Xavier meet when their units disperse. Their unit is attacked and it disperses, and they're left with each other. So they go on a journey within a jungle, trying to find the unit that left them. So this is why it's the mercy of the jungle. It's really a journey of them going through the jungle, because they can't take the main road, because they will be attacked on the main road. So they have to go within the jungle and try to seek their unit. And Faustine's character is young. He's seeking revenge for the people who killed his family during the genocide, while Xavier is haunted by what happened in the genocide, since he was an active participant in the genocide. So they have like a differing aspect about them. And that's mostly the movie. That's an introduction, but we'll talk more about it in detail. I think it doesn't hurt.
Yeah.
The experience of watching it still, we will really dive in properly about everything. So be ready for that. I wanted to say something, though. There's a quote Karekezi said during an interview I read of his. He's like, "I grew up in a region at war, and I use my films to ask whether humanism is still possible. How do we believe in humanity when we've lived through the Rwandan genocide or the war in Congo?" Which is, I think, really describes the film and even his previous film, The Pardon. It's quite interesting. Yeah, so I want to know your... before we dig into the aspects of the film, just your general view of the film. Just your general thought. Let's start with you, Joel.
Oh, yeah. I was blown away, I think, from, the first image. I think the first image was this big... I forget if it was a landscape shot or whether we started with Xavier running. But I was blown away with just the quality, really, of everything. And to see Uganda, again, throwing our props in that, see Uganda shot in such quality for me, was worth the price of admission alone to begin with. But the rest of the story is really powerful, really captivating. The message, especially what you just said, what Joel tries to tackle is like whether there's any, like humanity is still possible after we've done like all these horrible things to each other. I really loved the theme of the movie. The acting is done beautifully. The characters, the story, the landscape. I love where the story especially goes. The conversations between Faustin and Xavier. It's very beautifully told. I can see why it won. it's definitely earned its prize at the Sparkle.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. I'll just have to agree with Joel as well and say the first thing that really jumps out at you is the production value of the film. The overall production value is just great. Everything, as you said, from like the music and the cinematography, the acting is really top notch. So it's really an experience that pulls you in and you stay engaged. And throughout the movie, you're so in tune with everything that's happening and you want to know what's coming next. You kind of understand the subtle conflicts and the subtleties between like the friendships of the characters. So I felt like everything from like a production technical level to even just the story level was really well put together, and that's really what jumps out at you the first time, and you're hooked immediately from the first shot, as Joel said, till the end. You're hooked and you're in it. So I'd say those are like my general views on the film. Yeah,
that's great. I think I'm a bit tilted, not exactly where both of you are at.
Yeah.
I think it's really beautiful as well. I just, like, on a personal level, war movies are not my favorite. And it has it's a lot. It's such a war movie, and it feels so inspired by a lot of Hollywood movies that are great as well. Like the top, like the Apocalypse Now, that Spielberg one that has Tom Hanks.
Saving Private Ryan.
Those movies have something about them with really digging into the depth and the humanity of people at war. I think I had a distance towards that film because I'm not a fan of that.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't have good thoughts about the war. I'm not quite intrigued. I'm like, let's not do it ever. Like, so I had that not going for me. I much more enjoyed thinking about the film afterwards more than I enjoyed the experience of actually watching it. That is for sure. Like, thinking about what it was doing, thinking about the shots that it had, like, the thoughts about it and its existence were more interesting than the experience overall watching it for me.
Okay.
Yeah. So let's get into its main thing, which you guys have said is like the powerhouse about it, which is the way it looks.
Yeah.
I think let's talk about that. Its cinematography was done by a guy called Joaquin Felipe. His website is online. I think people could check it out. And he has worked on a couple of projects, things that I've showed in Cannes. He also worked on a Ugandan film. A bit cliches about the Northern War. It's like, that's the typical thing a white guy does.
Which film was that about?
It's, I can look it up. I just looked at it. I'm like, wow, this is the kind of thing that someone does.
Yeah.
It's called The Invisible Enemy.
Okay.
He's a Belgian... guy.
Yeah.
Just even the name itself, to call it invisible, it's just invisible to you.
Yeah.
Like, it's not invisible.
It's very visible to us.
Yes. it's a bit of a typical project, but if you see his website, his look is so crisp and sharp.
Yeah.
Like, his work, like, there's a reason why the film looks like that. It's so impressive.
Yeah.
I think I would really have to speak first for my favorite shot, which was the coiled tree. That scene was amazing. And I liked how it was shot because they kept the camera on a wide shot, and it was still for quite a while for when you could proper revel on how beautiful the thing was entirely coiled. Don't know what more you guys have to say about the photography and sound as well. I think let's talk about the filmmaking in general.
Yeah. I'll have to say that for me, technically, I also love the cinematography, and my favorite shots were definitely these shots that you would like kind of like intersperse between scenes, like the shots where it would show the mountains and the clouds just slowly drifting over them, and just creating that mood of like you actually feel like you're in the jungle yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and again, as you said, the sound of it also was pretty brilliant. And the way they did the score, especially the part when later in the film when Sergeant Xavier gets really sick and he's having malaria and he's having all these fever dreams.
Mm.
There's something really cool that they do with mosquitoes, which I thought was amazing because, you know, mosquitoes, the sound of mosquito bothering you is like something here in Africa we're very used to.
Mm.
And they kind of like used it to kind of portray like him losing his mind and going through these fever dreams. So I thought that was really, really cool. And then again, the editing, I would say, the pacing of the film was brilliant because it's a war film.
Mm.
And there are a lot of action sequences where they are like running or like they have to fight, especially later in the film. But the way they really pace it, like, I really love the pacing of the film because they would have these scenes that build up, then they would like cut to like something that is a bit more serene, and you actually immersed in the jungle, then they go back to the action. So I thought the editing was really well done as well, especially those three aspects especially were really cool for me on the technical level. Yeah.
Nice. Joel? Yes, sir.
For me, what was immediately fun, like one of the first things I think I fell in love with earlier on, like as a filmmaker, was like handheld shots, really, in any movie. So for me, all the handhelds in this were beautiful to watch. Like I watched some of the behind the scenes afterwards, and it was a joy to like see these guys working. And like for me, the joy of the a lot of the joy for me for the film, like even like the shots Timothy's talking about, all I was picturing was like how long it took to hike up there with all that equipment to nail like all these beautiful serene shots. I could feel the amount of hard work they put in, all the night shoots as well that they had to do was crazy. And they were like literally in the jungle. Because I think we've gotten, at least I've gotten used to like the whole Hollywood thing where they've been cheating with green screen. They make their cassette in the studio with AC and everything. So this felt like very grounded filmmaking. It felt like old school filmmaking. Like I felt like someone mentioned Apocalypse Now earlier. I felt like that grime of like you're in the actual thing, you know, and you can feel it. It shows on the actors' faces, and I think that's also what makes the story so powerful. I also really liked the setups. There was this one sequence where they attack the rebel camp like towards the end of the movie. I just loved how they designed that set, and also watching behind the scenes that they were constructing all these scaffoldings, mounting these giant floodlights. It was beautiful to see this much money poured into a production here, really. For me, it was just exciting to see all these things. And yes, everything else that Timothy said about the editing, that mosquito scene where he goes crazy, I was not expecting that. It was like really, really creative, very psychedelic, but a really good way to like show a fever dream. The technicals were amazing. Sound editing, camera, everything was nailed. And it's nice to watch really any African movie when you're not like thinking about the technicals. Like they're that good that you can sink yourself into the story. That's always a great thing. So yeah, really nailed it across the board.
That's really
I would
cool.
also just want to mention something we've skipped because in doing the research for the film, I noticed how much they won like awards for like costume and makeup. Yeah, and I thought that was pretty cool, especially with the scenes where they would show people like with gunshots and all that. And again, even just the setup, like the locals actually really did look like locals. Then the militiamen really looked like militiamen. There was the villain
Shout out who? Shakira.
Shakira. Yeah, I saw her in the credits. Yeah, she did
Yeah,
that.
Shakira Kibi. Yeah,
Shakira, she really
Kibirige.
did.
Yeah.
She's a
Ugandans are responsible for that makeup.
she's a
We're
well-known
getting our props,
Ugandan.
nice.
Yeah, Ugandan makeup, and she has I think worked in of Katwe films like that. So she was really in charge of all that, Shakira.
Yes, heavy hitter.
Heavy hitter. So, like, I really also appreciated the work she did on that front, especially also with the costumes and the soldiers. When their clothes were like tattered, they really looked like they'd been in the jungle for a long time, and you could really tell. And I also, as you say, then the places they chose to shoot, I think that was also really great. Like, just the compositions and picking all these spots, as Sharon mentioned, the carved tree. Then you would see the water where they actually found water, then the places where they couldn't get water, where they're like these bogs in the swamp. Like, I felt there was a lot of work that went into picking these locations, even just the scene where they're with a gorilla.
I was
Yes,
about to talk about that,
that was also pretty cool. I'm like, yeah, you guys had some really great compositions and you made some really good choices on the set. So, yeah, that's all.
I'm so happy when the gorilla showed up because, like, the first time, because they're talking about we're in a jungle, animals are coming for us. I'm like, oh my God, they're going to CGI something in a dream. I'm like, that is the best way to cop out. I'm like, it's definitely what they're going to do. And there was when they had like a guinea pig looking thing show up
Yes,
next to him. I'm like,
was it a warthog?
like a warthog. I'm like, Bambi, no budget. It was very cute to really. I was happy to see the actual gorilla show up, which is nice. I think I wanted to ask you guys something because I'm like, do you ever call a forest a jungle. I'm very confused on why they call it a jungle. Because I don't think you can say national park. That's just too government corporate shit. But a jungle. I'm like, would I be looking at, would I be in Kavale's, in Bunyonyi bushes and be like, I'm in a jungle?
No. It's but I think maybe for Congo, for Congo, because they have the Congo forest and they have these really dense uninhabited areas, and the story was taking place in Congo, I think it works here. But like personally, like I don't think in Uganda we have a jungle. We have Mabira, it's a forest. It's not a jungle.
No.
Yeah, but I think Congo there might be spots which are still really jungle and untouched. Or yeah.
Yeah, I also think like the just like the general sense of how the world thinks of a jungle would be more intriguing than to say Masi in the forest.
Yes.
I think I want to talk about something. Sorry, negative.
Yeah.
But at the ending, I think there's the one camera choice that I really did not find great.
Yeah.
At the end, the absolute end, when he's come from, because we have this thing where Joel, the shot you talked about in the beginning when he's chasing someone, we round back to that at the end, and we see him being chasing that person again. But there's the choice they make to make a wide shot, and we see everything at a wide angle.
Yes.
I wasn't crazy about that. I'm like, I felt like it robbed me of something.
Yeah.
I felt like the scene was so personal, and like it's such a like the fact that he is losing, like he's dying. I felt like I needed to see his face, so the choice to keep it at a wide angle was a bit disappointing for me. That was the only choice. It stood out to me so much because I was kind of eager to for them to bring it closer. It felt kind of was anticlimactic for me because of the camera choice.
Should I go, Joel? What do you think?
Like for me, specific to that scene, I felt like it worked with the way the film was flowing emotionally. I was at first disappointed with how he died, but then I got like the idea that this nigga was tired. He was tired like most of the movie already, had all these things weighing on him because he basically let that guy kill him. Like there was no reason for him to lose that situation. He had that guy down. This guy looks up at him, it's like, why aren't you firing? Nothing's happening. He shoots him dead. And for me, them pulling back up, I felt the loneliness of the moment and the loneliness of his passing, because he's dying in this giant jungle of a forest, whoever you ask. He's passing away in this giant, like this giant jungle, like all alone. And I felt like that was the mercy of the jungle. I felt like that was the staple shot, actually. Funny enough, of like the entire movie, I felt like it really encapsulated like the theme they were trying to go for, especially with his story. So for me, it worked like on an emotional level.
For me, I'd have to say that. Were you still going?
No, I was going to say Tim. You know?
Yeah, okay, I would have to say that it did work for me as well, because for two reasons. Because I would imagine that after what he has gone through with Faustin, and then he's chasing this other young militia boy, I think there was a moment of hesitation where maybe after what he... Because I think even the boy looked kind of similar to Faustin, I think similar age.
Yeah.
So I think maybe there was that initial hesitation because, he was maybe he had a bit of sympathy for, like, again, another young person lost in this big conflict. Then maybe that's how I would rationalize that. Then the second thing about the shot itself, because, it's a wide shot, but also I think it's a bit aerial.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's almost like a God's eye view of like that scenario. And as you say, Joel, like the loneliness, I think in the end they kind of show that Sergeant Xavier, like the many other people who died in this conflict, is just like one other person who dies in this place with no one around him, and they probably won't find his body for days.
Mm.
And they're just showing like how maybe God in general was looking at the conflict and is seeing like all these people just dying, and it may not have as much meaning, like in terms of like interpersonal relationships, like there's no one by his side when he dies. But I think that's like the brutality of war, as you said, like when you die, you never know when you're going to die in a war, and when you do, usually it comes in ways you don't expect, and you're usually alone. And when it happens, you're just another person who has died in the war.
Yeah.
You don't really have, you're just another body bag. You're not really. So I think maybe that's what he was trying to say, that in spite of him being this very important character throughout the film, and he goes through these great trials just trying to survive the jungle, in the end, when he dies, it's just another casualty.
Yeah,
so that's how I maybe saw it, and I rationalized it. Yeah, and I actually did like that shot at the end. I really liked it.
Okay.
I like this difference of
and
that
I think
shot.
Yeah, you actually. No, I would say I think he's actually right, because I'm remembering now also in the script itself, he does have this during one of the conversations with Faustine, and he's talking about how he thinks God is judging him, like how he thought, and it's like he's waiting for like God's justice to come down on him. And that might have also been implied with that aerial shot. Now that Timothy mentions it, I'm like, yeah, that makes sense. The God looking down at him, and like this is like God's justice, like at the end of the whole thing that he was dreading and waiting for. But yeah, that's, yeah. It's really powerful in here for me. Are you convinced, Sharon?
I am. I would rarely submit to, like, but I think I now could buy that as a point of view for that show. Let's now get into the other factors, the narrative and the characters in the film. I think this is mostly like a road trip movie, then turns into an undercover story, which is interesting, like how it turns into that. But one of the things...
Undercover
brothers. It's so wild. Like, I was like, really? This is what we're doing? I'm like, they were so... And the film is so subtle in the way it is. It's just in the small sentences. It's like, look at us. We are DRC.
Yes.
They think we're Congolese.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, really?
Yeah.
The thing which I wanted to talk about first, which kind of made me struggle to find an entry point of maybe entertainment. That's a broad word to use. But the thing that kept pushing me away from the film to find it intriguing at all is that the main antagonist is nature. And and I don't know why. The main antagonist is just the nature, the animals, like things. I don't know, that kept kind of drawing me away, because we see them go through, they struggle with, say, like the sleeping choices of sleeping up or down, the mosquitoes you're talking about, they drink pee, they're hunting for food, there's when he eats like a tiny military biscuit. Those are all things that are happening after one and after one another. And that this all happens in the beginning. I reached a point where I'm like, where are we going with this? I would genuinely say it kind of makes it a bit hard to watch that this is the main antagonist until we get into these intense moments when they then start going to the undercover story. That's when it really started to pick up for me. I don't know what you guys think.
I would say, like, the way I saw the I didn't necessarily see the jungle as the main antagonist. I think I saw it as a placeholder for the larger theme, which was like, on one side, you could see the jungle as like a metaphor for like human nature itself, because it's human nature that has gotten them into that place. Then this jungle in the middle of nowhere, fighting this pointless war for like revenge, like at this point, they're committing all these atrocities. And it's like I felt this almost confusion. It's like, yeah, they're marching west to catch up, but the whole time they're like talking about like why they're even fighting this war to begin with. And I think as Xavier is talking to Faustine, he's like uncovering that, you know, this, like, if I could go back, I probably wouldn't fight this war. My pregnant wife would maybe still be alive, maybe I could have a different life, I could be a farmer, I could be this, that. It's like the revenge thing isn't worth it. Being in this jungle that I've put myself in isn't worth it. And I felt like the hardship of the jungle really illustrated like the life they have committed themselves to. But I think there's even a moment where Xavier is like, he's given, when they get like caught and he has to like defend himself, like he's not a deserter. And he's like, you know, I've given my life, like my whole life for this army. And for me, that's what like the jungle was. Like the jungle is their lives as opposed to like it being nature itself. On the surface is at least the way I saw it. So narrative wise, I felt, for me, I was like in it. You talk about entertainment, which I get why you're feeling weird about the word entertainment. But yeah, but for me, yes, there was definitely entertainment value inside of that. Because thematically, that's the way I was looking at it anyway. Timothy, what did you think?
I also see a bit of what Sharon said, because I also felt mm-hmm. like they did not use the jungle as much as they could have mm-hmm. to like really make it this mm-hmm. big obstacle that's trying to kill them basically, instead of them surviving it. And I think what he mainly did was to dwell on the relationship between mm-hmm. Faustine and Xavier and just building on that. Of course, there are a few like struggles mm-hmm. they face here and there, but like they don't build enough on it. And I think I really liked the part when, I think sometime in the beginning, when they actually had to change clothes and they're walking past these locals and the locals actually turn on them like they are rebels and chase them.
Mm-hmm.
I would have loved if they were facing the jungle with again some sort of pursuit happening, maybe from like the locals themselves who want to like get rid of these rebels who are causing them all this frustration.
So
and
the pursuit of the Hutu guys wasn't enough?
Of the what?
The other Hutu rebels? Well, the other Hutu rebels that were around, where they killed Kantarama's character.
Yeah, no.
And then this dude with the afro.
Yeah, the ones who had the mine?
No.
Some sort of mine?
Yeah.
Yeah,
but those
yeah.
guys were Rwandese
yeah.
as well.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah, they were Congolese, but I think that came a bit later in the film, actually. Because I would have preferred if from like the get-go, when like they disbanded, maybe they have this gap where they're trying to figure out what they're going to do. Then in doing that, they actually now do meet the rebels, because I felt the ones at the gold mine with the Arab looking dude, the
mm-hmm.
red, I think they came much later. Maybe that's where you say that it became a bit more interesting for you, because now that's when they're in a village and these rebels were now, because they killed a woman at the gold mine. That's
I didn't
when,
like that plot,
yes,
though.
that's when they're actually
yeah.
now beginning to like chase them. And I think that's like maybe towards the last third of the film, it's not really so much the beginning. So I would have just like that extra bit of like tension and suspense and the extra challenge on them like surviving the jungle while again from the get-go being pursued, and that makes everything harder. And I think maybe from an entertainment point of view, it would even make it even more interesting. So yeah, I think that would be my main problem with the narrative. But otherwise, I thought he mainly focused on like building the relationship between Faustine and Xavier
mm-hmm.
as opposed to like them really being like at the mercy of the jungle.
Mm-hmm.
It was really these two people trying to survive this situation together, instead of it being like that the jungle is actually trying to kill them and they won't make it out alive.
Mm.
I could see that these people would definitely make it out of the jungle. Like I was sure they would. I wasn't worried like they will not make it. Maybe when he got sick, but I had a feeling they would eventually make it out. I was never convinced that they are going to die in the jungle. So yeah, that's just maybe something.
Though Faustin was hustling at the beginning.
Yeah.
That hike, man. A guy took him on hikes.
Yeah.
But like, I don't know, like I do see you guys' point, but I think why I enjoyed that first half before it gets like a little more dramatic or entertaining is I felt the exhaustion, like of being in the jungle, especially from like Xavier's point of view, as exhausted of Faustine. And then up that point where he like I think drinks Faustine's piss and explodes. Yeah, I was also just like, man, I am tired of this shit. So like when this other stuff like comes along the way, for me it like adds to the drama even more so because of like this setup that they made. But I do get it is a slow burn, I guess is what I'll say. And Slow burns are not also for everyone, or not for every movie. They don't always work for every movie. And it's a question of tastes. I completely get that. I think, like, going back to weak point, you're saying weak points in the narrative. For me, it was the ending, actually. That was a bit of a weak point for me. So, like, I liked the aerial shot, but then that, like, the wrap-up, because, like, the end, like I was wondering, which I'm sure you guys are wondering, it's like, did Faustine make it out alive? There's, like, this whole raid, it's like everyone has died. It's like Xavier is the only one left alive. You're like, what's happening? And then he goes out and gets shot. So the reveal for Faustine for me was just too rushed. It's like when I saw the little kid, like I got it. I was like, oh, he's alive. But the way it was done for me felt like it was too abrupt. I don't want to say lazy because they worked their asses off in this movie. But it's like in comparison to everything else, like the whole scene even felt out of place. Like it didn't, it felt like an afterthought, if that makes sense. Because it felt like the movie was supposed to end on that aerial shot, and it could have ended very strongly there if they just cut to black. But the Faustine wrap up for me was a little funny. That's the only thing really that bothered me in an otherwise great narrative experience.
Yeah. I would definitely agree with you on that as well. It felt some like they were like, how do we actually give this movie a good ending? Yeah, because this ending is maybe too dark. So they're like, yeah, let's show Faustine in this very brightly lit garden picking tea with his kid and all that. So yeah, I felt that was in a way not the best way to go about it. I would have preferred if at the end just ended with Xavier dying in the field as well. Yeah, but I feel like, again, going back a bit to a weak point, again, like you mentioned something about the part where he drinks piss in that. But I felt, now I felt that was also kind of rushed because it was just like, I think soon after they have started like that trick. And like, I would understand them like if they had been in the jungle for like, I don't know, weeks, no water. Then like he's just dying to drink something and he drinks the piss. But I was like, yo, this Faustine kid has tapped out real quick. He's already drinking his piss in like the first third of the movie.
Oh my God.
So like maybe that's what I would say. Like, I think that kind of thing is where I felt they could have built up much more. And then something like that drinking piss would perhaps even now have more energy, more power for me. But then thinking of like the strong points of it, I really loved the, as you said, he said something about in the quote by Joel Karekezi, something about humanism. And I really enjoyed how he actually tried to dwell on that a bit more through the characters, because a lot of the African war films I've seen, usually it's just about the violence and the dread and the darkness of it all. They don't really like dwell on like the light that can be that can exist in these very dark situations. So I really enjoyed that, like him building on these two characters who are Rwandese soldiers in like this strange Congolese land in a conflict which they probably don't have the right motivations for as well, was very interesting. But then another thing I would say was like from the historical perspective, like I felt they could have done a bit more with the Congo War. Like, maybe because I think the countries involved and the leaders of those countries, and I'm sure it's a sticky situation to really like almost indict these people for war crimes. Yeah, but I felt like they didn't maybe get as much into the motivations. They made it look like it was more about just militias fighting over gold, but. Yeah, they would have like also shown like the motivations for the Rwandese being there as well, because their motivations weren't entirely good. They weren't there just to liberate.
No.
Yeah, and even like the other forces, because this Congo War was considered like the World War of Africa.
Shit.
Yeah, it's called the Great African War. Mm-hmm. Like 5.4 million people died. Mm-hmm. Most deadly conflict since World War II.
Mm-hmm.
So like, yeah, and there were like plenty of countries involved, like the Zimbabwe's, Uganda. Mm-hmm.
Uganda
like,
as
yes,
well.
Yes, Uganda. And Uganda
because,
has these crimes.
Uganda
well documented crimes.
DRC.
Yes, DRC. We are currently paying for those crimes. So
we
yeah,
did
like,
collect our
yeah,
credits
like,
there, man.
Yeah, like I just feel like when... I feel like because they got a chance to like tell this story, I would have wanted to see something a bit more scathing and in-depth.
Yeah.
But then I understand like the politics and trying to be careful and not stepping on anyone's toes. But I feel there was like a lot to unpack in that film besides just like these two characters surviving the jungle. They could have thrown a bit here and there, like the different armies, maybe the Ugandan wing and what they were up to then. All that. So.
Man, that's a main thing for me because while I was watching the film, first of all, I'm like, I'm inclined to root for DRC because people have bled DRC dry, including ourselves, including the Rwandese.
Yes.
And so every single time when the focus was on the Rwandese and their strife, I'm like, guys, no, I get that the genocide is a big thing.
Yes.
And a thing I also kept thinking about, I'm like, Kagame was front and center when this film was winning. I'm like, you have to be in such support of your government for the leader of your government to support
actually,
the film that
present.
Way. So it is hard to... But you can also see it. But I'm also impressed as well that it wasn't that much of a PSA for genocide at all. I just wasn't happy with the DRC stuff. Also, they made the one... The violence is very little.
Yes.
But the rebel group was a DRC group. And it's the one time when it's really bloody.
Yes.
They give them shitty motivation behind a woman dying.
Yes.
I'm like, are you guys serious?
Yes.
I'm so impressed by that.
But,
like, that stuff I was really like... I'm going to root for DRC all the way. This film is not caring about it. Joel, that is so
First wait, you guys. Like, I don't know, like, I'm wondering whether, like, I heard different information during the movie. But, like what I had from the conversations with Xavier and Faustin was that the Rwandese soldiers, at least them, their particular battalion that was there because they were hunting Hutu rebels. So like, Muchivi's particular battalion, his Rwandese battalion, was like part of the Rwandese government, and they were there hunting Hutu rebels. So the way I saw it, unless I missed it completely, but that Afro dude, those guys were Rwandese themselves. They were Hutu. They were Hutu rebels. So it was these Rwandese trying to get at those Rwandese, then again fighting the Congolese at the same point. Because we even have Michael Wahuyo Sr. at some point when Thingy's there recovering from malaria, Xavier. Then he's like asking, wow, what rebels? Like Hutu rebels? And Wahuyo is like, it doesn't matter. Hutu, Tutsi, you guys are all fucking us up. Like, it doesn't matter which militia. You'll roll up in here, you mess with our women, you take our crops, you do what. So, for me, I feel like they actually captured the temperature of what was going on at the time, the chaos. Because I felt like, on this really intimate level, Xavier, Faustin, Muchivi's character, they felt justified in what they were doing there. They felt like we're justified, we're like delivering justice is what they keep saying, actually. It's like, I thought I was here to deliver justice, but now I'm killing babies, I'm killing women. Because he even talked about killing Hutu women and babies and stuff like that. And so like, there's just been so much killing, he doesn't know what they're doing there anymore. So I felt, at least for me, it did as good a job as you could. It didn't call people out directly. I'll agree with you, Uganda did not feature at all, which was a little weird for me. But like the rest of it, like those politics of like down there at the border, I felt like they captured properly. I felt like the Congolese were just people caught in the crossfire. They had all these militias happening. So for me, who I was rooting for were the Congolese civilians specifically. Because I agree with you, even the guys that were trying to hunt them down when they caught them with the sacks, those guys are armed with machetes. Like, they weren't coming for them with guns and stuff. Like, those are just everyday guys, the merchants, the farmers, getting caught in the crossfire. Like, all these militias that have their own powerful justifications for why they're doing what they're doing. Everyone's like, I'm a patriot, I'm this, I'm that. So for me, unless I, like, miss the mark, Like, I think the guys in that gold mine were also Rwandese, were also a Rwandese militia. And I think it was a mixture, because now I feel like the Rwandese then at the end came to like the camp and cleared it. But that camp was now also caught in a battlefield between Congolese and Rwandese. So it was this weird cluster, like clusterfuck basically, with Rwandese attacking Rwandese, attacking Congolese. So yeah, anyway,
I was just going to say, because like when I was actually reading up on the conflict, like it was also very much a Tutsi thing, like because even the people, because Kagame's motivations or Rwanda's motivations were like for them to actually go into Congo, because the Hutu rebels who had been expelled like during the genocide were now regrouping under Mobutu. So like Kagame's or RPF's motivation was to like end that rebellion, coming back and starting the genocide again. Whereas even in Congo, because they had to ally with people in Congo, like the people who were fighting Mobutu in Congo were also Tutsi, of also like the Kabila. Their tribe, I think Banyamulenge, are pretty much very close to the Tutsi. So even that's how you kind of see like how maybe the Ugandans got roped into it, and Tutsi Congolese were roped into it, and then they were showing the other groups. The other groups, I think, were more of like the normal other Congolese now, who probably don't want to be involved in this conflict involving Hutu and Tutsis happening in their own land, but they're just there because they have to face it. So, like, I feel they were like, as you say, there was like all this politics, but I feel they just like touched on it a little bit. And they didn't really like go deep into it. Like, of course, they mentioned these things like you're all rebels, but then like again, the motivations for the Rwandese being there, I don't think they were entirely also without a question. They also had their own shady motivations. They claim they're fighting Hutus, but they're plundering. Then there are all these other militias, which are not also only Rwandese. They're also like Congolese. Yes. So like just that, this how it all broke down, and the alliances getting deeper into like the politics between these alliances, why these Congolese, even that's why probably they could actually assimilate the Faustine and Xavier, because they were like, yeah, let's now be Congolese, because already they have like Tutsi or descent and all that. So like, yeah, there was that. I felt they should have really explored that, because that was at the heart of that conflict. It was very much ethnic tensions. But then, of course, they made it more about just like the war and plundering and all that. And yeah, which for me, I would have wanted to see, and maybe it's not as important, but yeah, I would have really wanted to see.
The major point was just to say,
yes,
this war disturbs the civilians, don't do it, don't do it. Although you talk about how it was Rwandese against Rwandese, but they also really make a point to make it known that they wanted the wealth that's there.
Yes.
I think it's intentional also for the rebels to be mining, because that's their focus.
Yes.
I don't know why I felt sure the rebels were DRC people. I don't know why I felt so sure they were Congolese.
Yeah.
I can't say maybe if they mentioned it or not, but I thought for sure that the rebels were Congolese, and also coming from the part that when they go back home, when they meet the unit again, they're like, you've been with them, and they never really say you've been with Hutu or Tutsi, which I think would not match politically for a Rwandese to be like, this is a Hutu or Tutsi.
Yeah.
So like a common an enemy that would make sense for them would be Congolese, because it would not match their whole.
They wouldn't bring back those tensions of like
back
the historic genocide tensions, because they really don't identify with Tutsi, Hutu
anymore.
I thought that was kind of like washed out, and they focused more on like the plundering and militias without really going into the politics of just the ethnic tensions and what led to this different, the war actually starting up. So, but yeah, that's maybe just me nodding out on war trivia.
I mean, I would say like, cause again with this movie, like I feel like the gaps in information are like done very, very purposefully, and also really keeping in the theme of Mercy of the jungle. Because for me now, that distance, because we had no scene like where like, oh, in Rwanda, or there's some flashback to like the genocide on Rwandese soil or whatever. There's nothing like that. And for me, that distance also like plays out like in the characters themselves. Then this other jungle foreign soil, they have their reasons that brought them there, like from home, but I think they've also been away for so long that it doesn't really connect, because like what you're saying, what they're doing now, they were like plundering resources, they were like committing sexual violence, destroying property, all these other things that really had nothing to do with their original objective. And for me, that distance really communicated. I feel it might also be a contextual thing, because I feel like it might be quicker to like pick up for maybe those people that have lived through the Rwandese genocide, might look at like the Rwandese depicted in this movie as really a distant thing. And maybe those who even like came back from like the RPF were probably not like unrecognizable. Like, as is war films, that tends to be a theme in war films as well. Like, you go out there, like with those American war films, you go out there, like, hey, freedom, what, kill a bunch of people, you come back and you're like, what was I doing? And I felt like that distance for me really hammered home like the theme of the film. So I think the limitations on purpose, which is why I'm inclined, because it was like that purposefully done, I'm inclined to like look at it as a positive rather than like a gap of like we could have used this, that. And I think also the fact that we're even talking about it to like this degree, the fact that Tim even went and like dug through the history, I feel like also the movie is doing its job. Because if you watch this and you know very little about that time period, I think you'd want to dig through and figure out like, wait, why were these guys fighting? How did we get here? Blah, blah, blah. So I think the movie did its job well, at least in my opinion. And I think the limitations are positive.
Okay,
we're almost running out of time. I don't know if each of you could maybe say something that you really want to talk about before we close.
About the film?
Yeah. Is there anything you've missed? Let me go first. I think the one thing I would want to say that I missed is I really liked how they create, at the end, it's really a passive thing they say, but there's this way they talk about Faustin in a mythological way, where they're like, oh, what is so special about him? And they're like, he killed a lion. Yeah. I really like that. That was a line that made me so happy. Yeah. It was such a nice continuous thing and really put the whole film in perspective on how things are told in such a wild way. People just assume what could have happened because their relationship is presented as quite intense between the two men. Yeah.
And
that was also
a Ugandan actor, Sam. I've seen him at Plenty of Maisha.
Yes, that's
Sam.
Yes,
it was also nice. You know?
Yes, yeah, I really, really like that. The one other thing I want to say, we shouldn't need to get into it more, but I felt like there were jokes that the film had that were not reacted to well by the people surrounding them. Like, there were like three jokes in the film entirely, one with Michael Waluyo Sr. And I'm like, is this a joke? Like, what's happening? Even the way he laughs.
The one
I'm
about
like,
bathing.
Yeah, I'm like, what?
I think that's a very African parent joke.
Oh, I think.
But I'll say my favorite joke was Joel's Atiku, where it's like monkeys are fucking. That's the best joke of the entire. That one landed.
Yeah.
I think that's when I would complain about the entertainment factor, because I'm like, why isn't this landing? None of the things were landing for me. Even like, that's it. That's the thing I would say for me. That's all I have to say.
Yeah.
I just want to, I just really want to also praise the acting in the film.
Mm.
I think all the actors really brought it, especially Xavier, who's Max Zinga.
Mm.
He's a Congolese actor. Then the boy who plays Faustine, it's Stefan Bach. I think
he's French.
And then even the Ugandan people, like, I just enjoyed seeing Abe Muchibi being like so contemplative, and he was great in this. Michael Waluyo, he
so
came for his scene and it was very powerful as well. Just the way he actually had that authority and gravitas, he actually looked like a chief. Yeah, so I really just want to like praise. I've spoken a lot about like technical stuff and the story and all that, but I was also really impressed by the acting, because for them to actually keep you immersed, I think they were also doing a great job in making this story come to life.
Mm.
And of course, the languages they were using, French and Swahili and all that. But yeah, I really want to praise the acting, and I think it's something that also deserves some props. They were really well rehearsed and well drilled. And I imagine they were shooting in less than ideal environments, in a forest, in a jungle forest and all that.
Yes.
So I imagine, yeah, it must have taken its toll for them just to make the film.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I really enjoyed the acting in the film. And they had a great cast with the Ugandan people, the main actors, even the dude who was like the rebel leader, the very light-skinned dude who was in Timbuktu.
Yeah,
yeah, like, they had a really good cast. They brought in some...
So good.
Yeah, so I just want to, like, praise the acting in the film as well.
Joel?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, I just want to, once again, like, hopping off of Tim, like, praise the effort, just the sheer effort that this film was. Like, I talked to, I think, a couple of the people, Ugandans that were crew members at the time, came back, people who are brown came back black as Jesus, you know? You know, weight had been lost, what? It was, it's just such an effort. And for me, like, any film really is hard to execute on a technical level. So for especially, and again, this hit builds up onto me praising also the director. So for you to maintain the level of passion and to maintain that energy throughout the entire process, because it shows the actors nail every single scene that they are in. There's no scene where I felt like, oh, that took me out, where I'd be like, oh, maybe he was tired that day or something like that. It was just... Oh my God. And I also agree with Timothy, seeing our legacy, Ugandan actors, Michael Wawoyo, Abe Muchibi, like, in a film this good, and see how great their acting can be, like, in really good hands. Because everything was making them shine, from the director to the camera, the lighting, the costume. So it was nice. It was nice to see them, like, at that level, see how amazing it actually was. And I really want to see more content like this. I really hope they push that to the fact that it was shot in Uganda, like, more. Like, I'd love the Ministry of Tourism to, like, just, you know, give more tax breaks, like, incentivize more people to come and, like, film here. We have, like, so many beautiful locations. Like, I really want, like, more invest. Like, I want to see more films like this made in Uganda. Like, this was such an achievement for me to see. It's much better than I expected it was going to be. Like, the way Imperial Blue, like, wowed me, this one, like, blew my mind, like, completely, that it was as good as it was. And yeah, I can't wait to see more from Joel Karekezi. Sharon mentioned his movie The Pardon. Like, if you want to see the amount of level up, like, a filmmaker can go through, Jesus Christ, yo, mate, everything, his visual language is amazing, his storytelling is amazing, like, thematically, like, especially the Francophone films thematically, I've noticed, are so strong. It's embedded into, I think, every single, like, level of production. It's amazing to see, like, really great effort. Congratulations to everyone that was a part of this. I am jealous.
Yep. This has been great. We have to close because I'm scared of this Zoom closing out on us when
you know.
Yeah, we would definitely all recommend this film. Please check it out on Vimeo. Buy it off there. Vimeo video on demand. It's 35k
just
to
20.
Buy and
yeah.
17k to stream for 48 hours.
I guess
yeah.
We'll have to share a link when we actually do put this out so people can
will share it for sure. But yeah, this has been our episode. Next week we're going to talk about the Ngalabi Short Film Festival, which starts we're recording on Thursday
tomorrow.
It starts on Friday, so depending on when you listen to this, it's on the weekend of 25th to 27th. Check that out. It's curated by Joel, and I'm moderating the panel, so it's very cinema red pill.
And I'll be present.
It's a family affair.
same thing. Right,
this is the exact same thing. Gosh, so please check that out. And our main platforms are now Anchor FM, Apple Podcasts, and we're on Spotify.
Yeah.
No more SoundCloud. Nice. Please don't look for us on SoundCloud. Yeah, yeah. We're now on those ones mainly. Yeah, that's it. Thank you guys for listening. We are back in action.
Yep.
And it feels good.
Really, yeah. Back with a bang.
Yep. Yeah. So this has been our episode. I'm Sharon.
I'm Timothy.
I'm Joel.
And bye-bye.